Namaste Bharat, my name is Disha Kodari, intern at Law Chamber of Siddharth Murarka, and today's webinar has been hosted by me. Today we have speaker Rishi Gupta, advocate Bombay High Court, and he will be speaking on today's topic, that is circumstantial evidence. Now I hand over the session to Sri Rishi sir for enlightening his vast knowledge and experience on this topic. Thank you. Now sir, you can continue.
Yes. Shall I take it?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, friends. Good to have you here on the first day of the month, first day of the week, and first day of the 5.0 lockdown. Well, before I begin this webinar on the point of circumstantial, on the law of circumstantial evidence, a note of thanks to the team of Siddharth Murarka, to my colleagues, my friends who have worked day in and out in editing the notes, in finalizing the notes, and in arriving at a proper conclusion to see that the notes see the proper light of the day. And also to Simran, who gave me an iPad to work on for preparing the notes. Friends, I believe everybody has received the notes, because that would be most important in today's webinar, as this is unlikely the past two webinars where I spoke without looking into the notes and I gave the narratives also without referring to the judgments which are relied on the notes. But today, since the law of circumstantial evidence would be in such a form that I would be constrained to refer to the notes, and I would request you that please open your notes. That would help you in understanding what exactly is the law of circumstantial evidence. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Tell people there's an invisible man in the sky who created the universe, and vast majority of it would believe it. Well, the law of circumstantial evidence is a different law. Some circumstantial evidence is very strong, as can be seen from the last page of my notes. Some circumstantial evidence is very strong, as when you find a trout in the milk, which does not require any proof. Now, trout is a fish. Let's understand this example. Viewers, if you could kindly please open the last page of my notes. This example would find there. It is important to understand the meaning of this phrase. The meaning of this phrase is that we never see a milkman mixing water in the milk or milk in the water. But when he delivers the milk to our house, and if we find a trout fish in it, then it's a clear-cut crystal evidence that the milkman has dipped water in the milk from the stream through which the fish has entered the milk and has come to our house. So this is a case of circumstantial evidence. The chain of suspicion is so complete that there is no other inference can be drawn from that phrase. That's only the milkman who has adulterated the milk by pouring water in it and by giving a delicacy of fish also to the milk. Now, witness testimony is normally flawed. A witness, though pure before the court, very rarely is able to utter the words verbatim as he is narrated before the police or during the investigation. There is always a likelihood of a miscarriage of justice if an acquittal of guilty is done, which is paramount also from a conviction of innocent. That's why we have the blindfolded lady standing in the courts of law, which is also referred to as the statue of justitia. It means that justice ought to be delivered without fear or favor, fair in every way. It means that justice is blind to parties in the court. It sees no color, creed, sex, the middle class, higher class, poor class. Court is only guided by the evidence and law. What is required is evidence. Evidence in the courts of law to punish the guilty. And if no evidence is found, however serious or damaging the case may be, the accused cannot be punished according to the whims and fancies. Because just because a certain section wants him to be punished regarding the importance of the case, but ultimately, what can lead to a conviction is only evidence. Now let us discuss what is a circumstantial evidence, coming on the topic of today's webinar. Circumstantial evidence is used in criminal courts to decide the fates of accused by establishing guilt or innocence through reasoning. According to Bentham, witnesses are the eyes and ears of justice. But witnesses, as I said, the testimony could sometimes be flawed. Now what is a circumstantial evidence? Friends, I have referred in my judgments contention, a judgment of Sharad Birdichand Sada. If you can kindly open it, which would find reference at page 31 in my notes. It's a landmark case of Sharad Birdichand Sada, which the Honorable Apex Court, as old as 1984, laid down certain guidelines, which I would read it for you all and then make it understand, which would cover in short the exactly the meaning of a circumstantial evidence. The circumstances from which the conclusion of guilt is to be drawn should be fully established. The circumstances concerned must or should and not may be established. I'll explain it once I read all these five lines. The facts so established should be consistent only with the hypothesis of the guilt of the accused. That is to say, they should not be explainable on any other hypothesis except that the accused is guilty. The circumstances should be of conclusive nature and tendency. They should exclude every hypothesis except the one to be proved, and there must be a chain of evidence so complete that the courts are left only with one and one probability, that the accused is guilty. If the two hypotheses come into the minds of the court that accused is guilty and accused could not be guilty, then the only possible inference that the court has to draw is that it should go in favor of the accused and accused has to be acquitted. Now, before I explain what was Sharad Birdichand Sada and other judgments, let us again turn back to my notes and come to page 5. Page 5 deals with circumstantial evidence, which is an introduction to circumstantial evidence. The concept of evidence. Evidence is defined in Section 3 of Indian Evidence Act. Now, Indian Evidence Act means, if my friends could see page 7, where the definition of evidence is given. The last portion, definition of evidence in Section 3 is not the real definition of some evidence. It's rather a statement of what the term evidence includes. Now, the next page from the notes would narrate, the term evidence means and includes all statements that are given by witnesses before the courts of law. So evidence means a statement made by a witness in the courts of law, which the courts have to gauge and assist and with the aid of prosecution come to a reasonable conclusion that the guilt of the accused is proved. But what happens in a case when there is no direct evidence? Now, Section 59 and 60 deals with oral evidence. Oral evidence and Section 61 and 62 deals with documentary evidence. Now, documentary evidence consists of primary evidence and secondary evidence. I'm just drifting apart from the topic for a minute because the topic would require this introduction. What is an oral evidence? What is a primary evidence? What is a secondary evidence? All this would require an introduction. If my friends could see page 9 of my notes, at subclause D, oral evidence and documentary evidence is well explained and defined and can be read into. I would be skipping all the relevant, all the irrelevant portion which my friends could read it, and I would be directly coming at page 10 where direct evidence is explained. Direct evidence is an evidence which goes to the directly to the very point in question. And the court does not have to require much when there is a direct evidence to prove the case. Subsequently, circumstantial evidence. Now, our webinar actually starts with page 10 at Roman clause 2. Circumstantial evidence is an evidence which is not of direct in nature. This is an evidence which is an indirect evidence. Now, the example is narrated here in the subclause Roman 2, at where A is tried for the murder of B. A had a motive to murder B. So subsequently, A was seen by somebody going with a sword, and subsequently B is found dead. So this is a circumstances which ultimately leads to a conclusion that if A had a motive, A was seen with the sword. So B's death could be a result of A's grudge towards B. Ultimately, there's a distinction between direct and circumstantial evidence as can be seen in Roman clause 3. I would come to page 11 of my notes at subclause F. Whether circumstantial evidence can be a sole basis of conviction. Yes, it can be a sole basis of conviction, as I narrated in Sharad Birdichand Sada's case, where the Apex Court has laid down guidelines, the five clauses which are mandatory to be fulfilled in nature, so that it can be the sole basis of conviction. But herein, I would read it at the cost of repetition. the conditions on which we depend for proving must be built up immovably. The condition must be exact. They should point towards the blame of individual. When every one of the conditions is taken in general, they should shape a total chain. There must be no escape in the chain. Now, this is as old as 1976 in Chanmal's case. Sharad Birdi Chand Sada's judgment is 1984. The law was well set up as old as Chanmal's case, then subsequently Anand Lagu's case, which have all been dealt in Sharad Birdi Chand Sada. Now, today also, Apex Court has come with a landmark judgment in Sonu versus Madhya Pradesh. Just today, this judgment is delivered by the Apex Court, where the death sentence granted by the Sessions Court was converted into life, and subsequently Apex Court has acquitted that person of the charge of a murder. The case was of theft and murder, and the person was found in possession of stolen property which belonged to the deceased. The Apex Court, while setting aside the conviction and the murder, observed that just because the person is found with the stolen property that belongs to deceased does not ultimately lead to a conclusion that he committed the murder of the deceased, and because the chain of circumstance only point out towards that he could be a thief but not could be a murderer. This is not covered in this note. This is just bypassed from the notes. Then coming to what is, if page 12 could be seen for a minute, what are the conditions prerequisite? Now, at the sake of repetition though, you all can read it. I would again read. What are the conditions prerequisite for arriving at a conviction, and whether circumstantial evidence can be the sole basis? Yes, it can be sole basis. I again repeat myself, provided the circumstances from the which the conclusion of guilt is to be established should be fully drawn. The facts so established should be consistent with the hypothesis of guilt and the accused. That is to say, they should not be explainable on any other hypothesis except that the accused is guilty. Page 13. The circumstances should be of conclusive nature and tendency. They should exclude every hypothesis except the one to be proved. There must be a chain of evidence so complete that not to leave any reasonable ground for the conclusion consistent with the innocence of the accused, and must show that in all human probability, the act must have been done by the accused. It is important to note that the entire chain of circumstances need to be complete. Failure to prove, I'm repeating, failure to prove even one of the elements would lead to an acquittal. Even if the entire prosecution case is proved, but failure to prove even one of the chains will lead to an acquittal even in heinous of the cases. Friends, here I know that not all scars show, not all wounds heal, not all illness can be seen, not all pain is obvious, but simultaneously, if the justice to victim is important, justice to accused is as important, because the fundamental principle of criminal jurisprudence is presumption of innocence. Circumstantial evidence would stand on a presumption of innocence. The burden completely rests upon the prosecution to prove the chain in complete whenever it is deciding a trial based upon the circumstantial evidence. If the chain is incomplete, even though then the accused is may be guilty, but he has to be must be guilty. The chain has to be complete. If the next page at page 13 is seen, subclause H, then this is a different section carved out under the Indian Evidence Act, which is useful in deciding cases of circumstantial evidence. This is section 106. In such a case, the burden of proving a fact within the knowledge of an accused shifts on the accused. But that does not mean that the prosecution's burden is discharged. The onus always lies upon the prosecution to prove the case. The burden never stands discharged. But this is an exceptional section of Indian Evidence Act, section 106, which says that if anything is within the special knowledge of a person, let's read the example 2, Roman clause 2. Suppose a person is traveling in a train ticketless and he's checked by a ticket collector. The burden of proving that the person had purchased a ticket and was carrying the ticket rests with the person who's checked by the ticket collector. The burden of proving will not go with the TC, because the TC's job is to check the ticket. If there is no ticket, then the burden shifts on the prosecution to show that this man was traveling ticketless and he has to be punished for that. So this is an example, though there is another example at Roman Clause 1. If page 14 of the notes can be seen for a minute. The last 8 lines from the bottom. I'll read it. Section 106 does not shift the burden of proof in a criminal trial, which is always on the prosecution, as I said. It lays down a rule that when the accused does not throw light upon facts which are specially within his knowledge and which could not support any theory or hypothesis compatible with his innocence, court in such an event, while deciding the case, can consider his failure to adduce any explanation as an additional link which completes the chain. Here 106 comes into picture. If friends could see Roman clause 4, which topic I would deal with while coming to the relevant topics. The provisions of 106 are important because let's see if two friends are going together, A and B. I will name them as A and B. And B is found dead after a certain point of time. Then the burden of proving that A has not done any offense would lie upon A, because A is the last person who's seen in the company of B prior to his death. It is only when A discharges that burden and the time gap is proved that A was not at the place where the B is found dead, but A was with him some hours or some minutes before his death. The burden that will have to be discharged is by A, failing which the courts can arrive at a conclusion that is A only who was seen in the last company of the deceased, and which can be raised as a link to convict the accused. But that does not mean the prosecution does not have to explain the case. The prosecution has to prove the case against the accused, but this is an additional link. If page 15 can be seen, now I would divide this circumstantial evidence to 4 categories. The first is motive. The second is last seen theory. The third is extrajudicial confession. And the fourth is section 27 of Evidence Act. I've dealt with all these 4 topics in my notes, but I would quickly browse through them and help you in understanding what exactly motive means, how motive is relevant, whether motive can be the sole factor in convicting an accused, and whether motive can be used further to enhance the prosecution case. Here, an issue is which is necessary. Page 15, I've dealt with the topic of motive. If the prosecution is able to demonstrate the motive behind the commission of the crime, failure to prove the motive would not damage the prosecution case. A conviction can be sustained or granted by the courts only if the prosecution is able to prove the motive, that this person had the motive to commit this crime. The failure to prove the motive will not be fatal. As Sukhpal Singh's can be seen, this was a case where the conviction was upheld in spite of the prosecution's failure to prove the motive, because the prosecution in Sukhpal Singh's case was able to demonstrate that this person had motive to commit the crime. Let us read the important relevant paras of Ujagar Singh at subclause C, page 16. The apex court, while deciding Ujagar Singh's case, held that in a case relating to circumstantial evidence, motive assumes great importance, but to say that absence of motive would dislodge the entire prosecution theory is perhaps giving this one factor an importance which is not due. The motive is in the mind of accused and can seldom be fathomed with a degree of accuracy. The mind of accused cannot be proved, because as I would read, the right thing with the wrong motive is the wrong thing. This is a proverb which I have quoted. The right thing with the wrong motive is the wrong thing. So if the mind cannot be proved of an accused, but if the prosecution is able to demonstrate that an accused had the motive to commit the crime, then with this could be an additional link in the chain for the prosecution to prove its case. But in all cases, the onus rests solely with the prosecution. It does not shift. Again, I'm repeating, it does not shift, because also while deciding a trial, the proverb that if two views are possible, in the mind of the court, then the one which favors the accused should be relied upon. As I've said, let 10 convicts escape, but one innocent should not be condemned. Here, again dealing with motive, I would request my viewers to come to page 70, subclause C. It's a long para. It deals with a very landmark judgment of Surinder Pal Singh's of 1993, where Apex Court, while observing that first three lines, motive plays an important role in the case hinging upon circumstantial evidence. Motive is a reason which induces and actuates a man to do a certain act. Now, motive, there is no direct evidence. Motive is always in the mind of a man or the person who commits the crime. So unless the motive is demonstrated, though not proved, the prosecution cannot carry its case further. There has to be something to be shown by the investigating agency or the prosecution to show that this crime is committed by this person because he had this motive. So he could be placed under the radar of suspicion at the initial stage. But the prosecution will have to prove its case with that demonstration and to carry its case further that this motive has led to the commission of this crime. I have covered Surinder Pal Singh's judgment in the middle portion of subclause C. There is an inevitable long distance to travel between may be true and must be true. And the whole of this distance should be covered by legal, reliable and unimpeachable evidence. I'll again read legal, reliable and unimpeachable evidence. This means that even though the motive is demonstrated, this would automatically not prove a person guilty. The job will have to be done by the prosecution that this was the motive. Now, this is the case. This is the evidence based upon which, if the chain of circumstances are complete, the courts can convict the accused. But if the chain, if any cog in the wheel is missing, then the wheels cannot drive the car. The accused has to be acquitted. There is no other option. Further, the subclause D may be seen. Second line, presence of motive may lend support to the prosecution case, but its absence is not always fatal. This is decided as old as 1983 in Ishwar Dhan's case. Page 19 may be seen for a minute. The seven clauses which are most important, which would explain whether motive is a relevant factor, whether conviction can be based upon a motive, whether conviction can be based solely if the motive is demonstrated, or something more is required to show that yes, apart from motive, also these chain of evidence is need to be seen. I would read this very quickly, 1-7. So it is not incumbent upon the prosecution to prove the motive for the crime. It often happens that only the culprit himself knows what moved him to a certain course of action. Now the culprit's mind, as I said, cannot be proved in the court. But where the crime is alleged to have been committed for a particular motive, it is relevant to consider whether the pattern of the crime fills in with the alleged motive. In serious offenses like murder, the court always searches for motive, and motive plays a very, very important role. Motive is of great importance in cases based on circumstantial evidence, and when there is absence of motive, the court should carefully examine the absence of motive as a circumstance in favor of accused. Where the motive is absent, it is always a circumstance in favor of accused. So I'll pause here for a minute. It does not mean that always when there is a motive, the circumstances goes against the accused. And this is one of the most important lines at Roman 5, that where the motive is absent and when only some circumstances lead towards the guilt of an accused, but without any motive, without any other evidence, then the chain of circumstances is deemed to have been unproved and accused deserves to be acquitted. Where there is clear, cogent, positive evidence connecting the accused to the crime, the question of motive is no important. In such a case, this would fit in a category of direct evidence. If motive is established, the adequacy of motive is not in all cases necessary, and motive, no matter how adequate, cannot sustain a criminal charge in absence of clear and cogent evidence pointing to the guilt of accused. So only motive cannot lead to the guilt of accused. Something more is required by the prosecution to complete the chain of evidence. So with this, motive is explained as sweet and short as I could due to the curtailment of the time. But the second link which could be drawn in a circumstantial evidence, as I have discussed earlier also, is the last scene theory. Now, last scene theory, if page 19 could be seen to my notes, is at Roman A. Last scene theory means in which two people are seen together, out of which one is alive and one is dead. It's as simple as this. One is alive, one is dead. So it is upon the person who is alive to show under 106 of Evidence Act as to why he should not be shown as an accused and pronounced guilty. If he discharges the burden, then though the burden lies with the prosecution, the burden completely shifts upon him. And it is completely now resting with the prosecution to prove the chain of evidence so conclusively that there's only one hypothesis which leads to the guilt of accused, and there is nothing else connecting the accused, and the chain of evidence is so complete that there is no inference other than the guilt of accused can be drawn, and there is no scope for acquittal. If subclause CC, doctrine of last seen, if proved, shifts the burden of proof into the accused, placing on him the onus to explain how the incident occurred and what happened to the victim, who was last seen with him. If subclause F is seen, before that is subclause E is seen, the last seen theory furthermore comes into play, where the time gap between the point of time when the accused and deceased were last seen alive is found dead is so small that the possibility of any person other than the accused being the author of crime becomes impossible. Subclause F, I will not read everything. The last seen theory as a facet of circumstantial evidence is a weak kind of evidence. Now, this is weaker than the motive, because he could be last seen with the deceased, and suddenly after going a few steps ahead, some unfortunate incident could have happened with the deceased. But it is ultimately upon the person alive to show that though the deceased was with me, I am not the perpetrator of this crime. The possible suspicion initially goes on him, but once he takes the aid of Section 106 and is able to demonstrate in the courts or before the investigating agency that I am not the perpetrator of the crime, then the entire onus of proving the crime shifts to the prosecution, and the courts, in absence of a complete chain of circumstances, cannot convict the accused. If page 20 could be seen, at subclause H, the last two lines, there must be something more establishing connectivity between the accused and the crime. And then at subclause G, the first two lines, circumstances leading to last seen together does not necessarily imply that it was accused who has committed the crime. If the circumstances are limited to just last seen together without further corroboration, conviction cannot be based. As I just explained, that just merely being last seen together, out of which one remains alive and one dies, cannot itself ipso facto lead to a conviction. Something more is required. That is why I said that out of between motive and last seen theory is a weak piece of evidence. So only because the person was last seen with the deceased cannot sustain a conviction. Something more is required to complete the chain. This would be found in Ashok's case of 2015, where Apex Court dealt with where the sentence of conviction of life was set aside and the accused was acquitted. This is a perfect case of last seen theory, where two courts below sentenced the accused to life, but Apex Court said that the circumstances does not lead to a conclusion that it is the accused himself who was, though last seen in theory, the chain does not get completed. Then Niranjan Panja's case of 2010. Now I come to my third explanation, that is of extrajudicial confession. Now this would be a bit confusing, that is why I have drawn a table at page 22. Don't just jump to page 22 as of now. First, let us see what is a confession. Confession is defined in section 24. It's one of the species of admission. Confession is not defined in the Act. It comes under the bracket of admission. Kindly see subclause B at page 21. There's a difference between extrajudicial confession and a judicial confession. Judicial confession is one which is made in the immediate presence of a magistrate. Now, kindly revert to page 22, where the table is self-explanatory and it's made in such simple and presentable form that further explanation to this would hardly be necessary. Apart from the fact that I would again trouble that there are two types of confession, judicial confession and extrajudicial confession. Judicial confession is the one which is made to a magistrate under 164 during the time of investigation or during the time of committal, and extrajudicial confession is made to a person who is can be a police officer during investigation of an offense, or can be to any person. It can be a written or oral. Judicial confession need not be proved by calling the person before whom the confession was made as a witness in the courts of law. Extrajudicial confession, though being a weak piece of evidence, the person to whom this extrajudicial confession is made will have to be examined as witness. Extrajudicial confession is also a very weak piece of evidence, and conviction can very rarely in extraordinary circumstances can be based on extrajudicial confession. Extrajudicial confession always requires some other corroborative evidence, whereas judicial confession does not require corroborative evidence because it's a confession made to a magistrate. Extrajudicial confession can be retracted, the retracted effect of which is that it makes the trial weak if the prosecution does not have any other supporting evidence. Now, kindly see page 22, subclause D. As I said, extrajudicial confession can be in writing or in oral. If it is in writing, then the writing itself is the best evidence. But if it is not available or is lost, then the person before whom it is made, the person to whom it was given in writing, will have to be examined in the courts of law. Let's take an example at page 23. Friends could come to 10 lines from the bottom, beginning with, if the rule is inflexible, that the court should insist only on exact words more often as not, this kind of evidence, sometimes most reliable and useful, will have to be excluded, for except perhaps in a case of person of good memory, many witnesses before whom extrajudicial confession is given may not remember the exact words, exact sentences, exact lines. In such an event, courts have to be circumspect and not rely upon the exact words, but have to see what the witness wants to say and whether the extrajudicial confession can be relied upon, supported by the other evidence pointed out by the prosecution. This, if the table is seen, that would be self-explanatory. And in Sedevan's judgment at page 24, subclause E, extrajudicial confession is explained. And starting with, the apex court said that extrajudicial confession is a weak piece of evidence, and while relying upon extrajudicial confession, due care has to be taken while separating the entire case of prosecution. Sedevan's case, Parikswami's case, all, and Aloknath Datta at page 25 deal with, including Ramesh Bhai's case, deal with extrajudicial confession. And it is always has to be seen with suspicion. Something more is required. As I said, that is why, as I said, the concept of presumption of innocence rests more with circumstantial evidence, because everything that leads to circumstantial evidence is seen either with suspicion or is seen as a weak piece of evidence. Motive solely cannot be a base of conviction except in rare circumstances. Last seen together cannot be a base of conviction only on its itself. The prosecution has to stand on its own legs. It cannot derive from the disadvantages of the defense or the weak defense laid down by the accused. Let's say an accused raises a defense of alibi. Alibi means a person is somewhere else when the crime is being committed and the accused is charged with, and the alibi fails. Can the prosecution say, without proving its own case first, that because the accused has raised the defense of alibi, now he needs to be convicted? We need not prove our case. Alibi can be drawn support, but the prosecution will have to prove its case first. Then only it can take the concept of false defense raised by the accused as a supporting evidence to convict the accused. Otherwise, if the defense of accused was thought to be taken by the prosecution convicting him, then nothing would have to be done by the investigating agencies and the prosecution. Let the accused take a defense. If defense is false, accused has to be convicted. This is not the concept of a criminal trial. That is why even in circumstantial evidence, the concept of motive, last seen together, and extrajudicial evidence has been considered, though as an evidence, but a weak piece of evidence. Now, coming to page 28, section 27 of Indian Evidence Act. Here, all viewers who have been listening, possibly everybody knows what is section 27. Though, I would again repeat it, taking some of our more valuable time. Page 28, line 2, line 3 is seen. Section 27 of Indian Evidence Act, the article must be within exclusive knowledge of the accused, and if it is in knowledge of someone else, then the recovery goes away. It's an exception to section 24, 25 and 26 of Indian Evidence Act. Let us read what exactly is section 27 as subclause C. it's a rule of caution and prudence that when recovery is affected and the memos of recovery are prepared, time and again, Apex Court by way of landmark judgments have been harping upon that independent witnesses are required. Independent panchas are required. They should not be panchas which are affiliated to the police station or which are known to the police. Because this recovery, which is effected from the accused during the course of investigation, can be one of the cogs in a circumstantial evidence case. If Section 100 is seen, it provides that it's a mandate of law that to avoid the credibility and truthfulness of factum of recovery, the purpose of preparing a punch, requiring a punch to the witness of recovery, is that the punch should be an independent person, a respectable person from the locality. If these things are not done, then the credibility of the panchnama can be destroyed and damaged and can be looked upon as a suspicion. And if the recovery was known within the knowledge of others also, then that recovery is made farce. It cannot be relied upon, as has been observed in Singha's judgment. Further, I have in page 29, as far as section 27 are concerned, I have relied upon John David's case, Ram Balak's case, to prove that how recovery of such natures under 27 are also seen with suspicion. It is not a weak piece of evidence, but it is looked upon with suspicion in Chengareddy's case. If the case is based on circumstantial evidence and the recovery is found fault with, then the chain is broken. In spite of the case being of heinous nature and the crime being of a high magnitude, the prosecution proving its case in all aspects, but the recovery was found to be doubtful, Honorable Apex Court in Chengareddy's case overturned the conviction and set up and gave a judgment of acquittal in favor of the accused. Now, as I said, at page 31 is a landmark judgment of Sharad Birdichand Sada. Friends, here at page 29, I have started with all the judgments in my notes. But I would say that looking to it, Sharad Sada is a judgment which dealt with dying declarations, which dealt with abatement of suicide, which dealt with circumstantial evidence, we dealt with practically everything. The entire evidence was reappreciated by the Apex Court. It was a case where death sentence was inflicted upon the accused by Honorable Sessions Court, confirmed by Bombay High Court. But ultimately, Justice Fazal Ali, in a five-bench judgment, deciding this case in 1984, observed that the circumstances, the matter may be grievous, very serious, but the circumstances ultimately do not lead to a hypothesis that ultimately points out toward the guilt of accused. All the circumstances are not proved. So the death sentence was converted into an acquittal and the accused were let off. Subsequently, another judgment is, which all of you may be accustomed with, is Arushi murder case. Till date, nobody knows who killed Arushi. The trial court convicted the parents, Dr. Talwar and his wife, of life. Honorable Allahabad High Court, while passing remarks against the trial court of acting like a person in the circus, acquitted the parents, or subsequently the state has preferred an appeal and the appeal is pending in Supreme Court. Till date, the circumstances are unclear as to who killed their daughter in their own house. The local police could not do a proper investigation. The CBI failed to find out the culprits. Ultimately, the parents were arrested, shown as accused, because they were the person sleeping in the house along with the servant who was found dead. So they were convicted. But Allahabad High Court said that the chain of circumstances do not lead to a complete conclusion, that it is only one and one person which leads to a suspicion. So if the chain is incomplete, the person deserves acquittal, no matter how serious the crime may be. Then there is Shivani Bhatnagar's case, where an IPS officer had to undergo a sentence of 9 years, ultimately before he could walk out as a free man in an acquittal case. Then there is the Sayyed Modi murder case, in which the wife and the best friend of the accused, the nation lost a great badminton player. And he was shot in broad daylight. There's a subsequent serial coming on in Zee, the Chashi, on Sayyed Modi murder case. Though the wife and the best friend, who had an affair amongst themselves, were roped as the accused. Subsequently, after Chashi was filed, they were discharged, saying that just because they had an illicit relation, that does not mean that they had a guilty mind to commit the murder of the deceased. She had lost her husband, the friend lost his best friend. Ultimately, they had to go a certain period of incarceration, but they never faced the trial. They were discharged. The discharge was tested in the Apex Court. Apex Court threw out the challenge of the center. Then, let us rely on two judgments of American courts. O.J. Simpson's case. Now, O.J. Simpson was convicted for the murder of his wife. Ultimately, in spite of fingerprints being found and his glove being found in the house, when the glove was opened in the court, the glove did not fit O.J. Simpson's hand. Subsequently, the jury found that even though he was cruel to his wife, he used to assault his wife, he used to ill-treat her, this cannot be a circumstance to prove him guilty. And the jury's verdict was that O.J. Simpson is not guilty of any charges of first degree or second degree to his wife, and he was let off. Then there's a case of Scottley Peterson. They had a love marriage. This is an American case which I'm dealing with. They had a love marriage. They had a child after the marriage. And one fine day, the child and the wife were found dead near a lake. At that time, Scottley Peterson was far away from that place. He was the main suspect because he had an illicit affair with some other lady. And subsequently, forensic evidence and his car, nothing was found. But still, the jury found him guilty of first degree of murder of his wife and second degree murder of his son, because the lady with whom he had an illicit affair often used to speak that he was tired of his life and he didn't want a baby at this stage. So only on this inference, Scottley Peterson was convicted to about 50 years of sentence. Friends, circumstantial evidence is a very vast topic. This cannot be covered in a webinar of within such a time frame. But the main topics that need to be satisfied, the main thing, summarizing my conclusions, is that the chain of circumstances should be so that it leads only to one inference, that the accused is guilty. If the chain breaks, or if the cogs in the wheel start disintegrating, then the courts have no other option, as I say, no other option, even though the case is serious or it's a media trial, except to leave the accused, because the circumstances, though suspicious, do not point out completely to the role of an accuser, saying that he is the only person who could have committed the crime. Because if the circumstances are inconclusive, then there's a possibility that the crime could have been committed by someone else. Motive is one of the ingredients. Last seen theory is one of the ingredients. Extrajudicial confession is also one of the ingredients. But time and again, as FX courts have been saying, that all these are weak piece of evidence and something more is required apart from extrajudicial confession and last seen together. Conviction cannot be solely based upon this. So Sharad Birdichand Sada's judgment, my friends, is a landmark judgment. If some viewers who have not read it, kindly go through it. This judgment will help everyone understand what exactly is a dying declaration, what exactly is abetment of suicide, and what exactly is circumstantial evidence. With this, I conclude my webinar. Thank you everyone for being there. God bless.
So participants, if you have any questions, then you can post the same in the chat box.
Are we doing a live question, sir? Are you putting a live question?
Yes, sir.
Yes. I'm not audible?
No, sir. Actually, since there are... there is one question.
Yes.
When motive is demonstrated, then how the burden lies upon the prosecution? Kindly explain.
Okay. In all cases, I'll just shift and answer this question. In all cases, the onus is always on the prosecution to prove the case. But if motive is demonstrated, then it strengthens the prosecution case that this person with the motive had the reason to commit this crime. But if once motive is demonstrated, the prosecution case becomes easier to prove. But that does not shift the burden from the prosecution that yes, motive is there, so accused can be convicted. Ultimately, the case has to be proved by the prosecution that this was the motive which led to the committing of this crime. It should be connecting to the crime. And this I have dealt with in page 19, subclause 8 of my notes.
Next question. Can a change of circumstantial evidence be used in a way to prove that accused is not guilty?
Please come back. Change of circumstantial evidence. It's a chain of circumstantial evidence. chain of as I said in Sharad Birdichand Sada's case of 1984 Supreme Court, the chain of circumstantial evidence should be so complete that only leads to one conclusion that the accused is guilty. But if two views are possible from the chain of circumstances, then the view which favors the accused should be used. That is, the accused should be acquitted. The five clauses as narrated in Sharad Birdichand Sada's judgment, in another judgment of Anand Chintaman Kale, the five clauses will have to be read in every judgment. If you see any judgment of circumstantial evidence, then these five clauses are most important.
Next question. Please explain our DNA importance as circumstantial evidence.
DNA. Now, DNA test, first of all, is not a compulsory test upon the accused, as has been held in Selvi Jayalalitha's case of 2010. But if the accused volunteers to go a DNA test on his own, then the DNA report is directly admissible in the court. Accused cannot subsequently challenge that DNA report, but he can cross-examine the witness and on the certain points. But if the DNA test has been taken without the consent of the accused, then the DNA test is not, the report is not admissible. It is hit by Article 21. Selvi Jayalalitha's case of 2010 is very, very clear on this. The forcing of an accused to undergo DNA, narcoanalysis, brain mapping is hit by Article 21. It's only in extraordinary circumstances, and that too when the accused consents to it. But if the accused does not consent to it, then adverse inference can be drawn, which can be used as one of the chain of circumstances. Let's say if a hair is found on a body and the accused is found near the body, then if for testing that hair, if the accused refuses to undergo the test, or refuses to give his hair samples, then that refusal can be seen as one of the chain in the circumstance against the accused.
Okay, next question. Could you throw some light on use of circumstantial evidence in the matters of rape and post-fact?
Let's say there's a landmark judgment of Madras High Court in 2014, where a child was brutally murdered and raped, sodomized, and the charges of 376, POSCO, kidnapping and unnatural intercourse, everything was levied against him. Madras High Court granted him death sentence, observing that in a POSCO case, as I would say, DNA came into picture because the semen was found on the child. It was tested. Forensic lab found hair samples on the body of the child, and the accused had a grudge with the family of the dead child. So this was also found as one of the motives that he could be the person who kidnapped it. Subsequently, DNA, forensic, all led to an ultimately conclusion that it was the accused himself who had abducted the child, committed rape upon her, sodomized him, and then ultimately, to conceal the evidence, had killed him.
Next question. What is evidentiary value, fingerprints in court of law?
Evidentiary value of fingerprints in the court of law.
Of law.
Evidentiary value of fingerprints would be sustainable in the court of law if something more is there to connect. This again would be found reference in Selvi's judgment of 2010. Because these are all expert evidences. Expert, barring some expert evidences as meted out in section 293. Not all opinions of experts can go directly in the courts of law. If a fingerprint expert gives an opinion by taking the fingerprints, then he has a accused has a right to cross-examine him and destroy his credibility. If the fingerprint evidence is able to sustain, if able to show to the court that all the procedures are properly followed and the fingerprints lead to an accused only, this accused is waiting the trial, then, and if there is some more evidence to it, then a conviction can be safely based upon a fingerprint expert evidence also. O.J. Simpson case, I would again come back to one of my judgments. The gloves which O.J. Simpson was wearing were found, right-hand glove was found in his house, which was used as an evidence in the courts of law. But that evidence, even though fingerprints of O.J. Simpson were on the glove was not fitting O.J. Simpson's hand. So ultimately, jury said that just because the fingerprints are on O.J. Simpson's right-hand glove, it does not fit his hand. Why would he be so foolish to leave this glove at the scene of offense? So the jury acquitted him. This theory can, the entire O.J. Simpson trial can be seen in Netflix in O.J. Simpson murder case.
Next question. next question. What evidentiary value of 164 statement can defense call magistrate for cross-examination 164 statement of accused person?
164 cannot be used in a circumstantial evidence. As I said at my table, there's a judicial confession and there's an extrajudicial confession. If accused has given a confession following the proper procedures of law and the magistrate has recorded it, that confession can be used against him to corroborate the case of prosecution. But that cannot be a sole piece of evidence against him. That can be used if the prosecution is able to prove the case against the accused, subsequently with the aid of the accused himself by giving his confession.
With this, we come to an end. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us on today's topic. It was indeed a very informative session for all of us. And I am sure the same will surely help us in uplifting our profession to the new heights. We are looking forward to have many more sessions by you in the near future. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.